Let's talk about your style. And I guess one would describe it as a combination of romance, of emotion, and of harmony. Can you describe or dissect the components, though, that make the Bee Gees what they are, creatively?
Oh, it's a little bit difficult, because from where we're sitting, it's not that easy to be that objective.
You'd like to sit over there?
No, but it's hard to be objective about something like that. I mean, we've grown up doing what we do, and the impressions that people have on us is not necessarily our impressions of ourselves.
It's very hard for us to perceive ourselves.
See, we see ourselves as opera singers with banjo.
It can be difficult. Which throws a real wobbler into the situation sometimes.
Really does, yes.
But we see ourselves as writing, perhaps R&B music is really our forte, yeah, or the music we love the most.
And, yeah, I think most of the... See, we have phases. Our earlier music was a lot more romantic and balladeering rather than the later music, which tends to be more R&B-based and soul-based.
Is there a formula for a number one hit? You start with this and there's a middle and...
No, what happens is that when you've been writing songs like we have, because we write our own songs, when you've been writing for a long, long time, you get a feel for how to build the build of a record. There's a beginning and there's a middle and there's an end, and you have a build. And there's a certain way that you have your high moments and your low moments, and you get used to this. It's almost like going to school and graduating. You get to learn a certain skill about writing records.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's a gift, but it's also a craft. So.
If I said to you, can you write a hit for me in the next 2 or 3 days,
could you write down what we thought was a commercial record?
Yeah.
And then, if you write a commercial song, we know it's commercial, and then there's a halfway mark.
I maintain that if we put our minds to it, we would write what we firmly believe is a hit record. And when it happens and you hear it and you sing it to each other, there's a feeling about it, and we look at each other and we think, this is a hit.
I guess when you write and produce for someone like Barbara Streisand or for Diana Ross, it would be a very different deal to producing or writing for one of your own albums.
Well, you've got to remember that you're writing for a woman. If it's a woman, in fact, you're writing for, like Diana Ross or indeed Barbara, it is a woman, and you're no longer writing for a man's thoughts. So it's like directing a film in a way. You have to put words in their mouths and you have to give them the right thing to say for them.
We had to wear a dress for 3 weeks.
We had to wear dresses for a couple of months.
Yes. You, for instance, Barbara Streisand would want to say something that, about how independent she is, because she is. So in her records, you might want to incorporate a little bit of that independence, like I'm a woman in love. It's her right. It's like things like that. And she was a little afraid of singing a song like that.
So you kind of become her.
Her voice becomes another instrument.
not all the way.
Not all the way.
Makeup, yeah.
Not even once.
Well, you have, you have to draw the line somewhere.
Yeah, just to the wig. Yeah.
But you do, you have to, it's like acting. You have to assume the role mentally and write in that way. But writing for Kenny, I guess, we're all white beards.
Yeah, sure. Cowboy hats. Yeah, but it was fun writing with Dolly Parton.
You must be one of the very few family groups which are still together, 3 decades of performing. Why are you still together?
We all owe each other money.
I see, it's easy to say.
Primarily because we're brothers, probably.
Yes, I mean, we're each other's best friends. And we all have our houses close to each other.
It was a dream. If anything goes wrong, we can sue each other.
Pointless, isn't it? We've been singing together from the ages of six and nine. You know, it's like all through our lives, we've always done things together.
So, six and nine last night.
Yeah. it's been a bumpy road for us. It's not a straight, narrow road for this group. We've had our ups and downs through the years. And I think that the reason we're together today is that we have that in common.
Our musical goals are the same.
I want to talk about Ego.
Hello? He left us about 2 years ago.
Ego did? That's the fifth brother, right? Ego, right?
Well, he was the worst drummer we ever had.
Yeah. The worst drummer?
Yeah, him and Yvonne.
Does it come up, though, sometimes? Have there been times in the group's career where Ego has played a big part in that?
When we were growing up, there was little Ego problems, who sang lead on what and things like that.
Yeah.
But nothing more. Today it's more of a constructive arguments rather than...
It's basically the behaviour of teenagers, but placed in the situation we were in, it comes out in that way, you know. Mm-hmm. It just came out in our music, and we were all... Individualism, I guess. We were all searching for our own individual identity. Because we know where we are, we know what we're doing, it's a different thing. You acquire your craft, you know, you get better at it.
In fact, the ambition is more so now, because we're all focused on where we want to go and what we want to do and what we want to accomplish. Mm. And it's not divided between the three of us into different directions. Yes.
There'll be many changes in your lives. Your latest album, One, is dedicated to your late brother, Andy Gibb. And you're quoted as saying that Andy's loss brought about spiritual changes for all of you.
It does change you very much. It shocks you into different realizations. When you lose somebody very close to you in your family, it was a very spiritual thing for us. We can't, in fact, accept the fact that Andy is not there. We always accept we accept the fact that he's somewhere. And I think when you lose somebody close, they don't go away. They're out there somewhere. And I think that causes a new curiosity, and you start buying books about life after death, and you start becoming more and more interested in the metaphysical side of life.
It's nice to believe in it, yeah. I think if I had a choice of believing in the other, then I'd go for this one.
What about you, Robin?
I have a different view of it. I mean, I'm spiritual anyway, and I believe that there is an ongoing thing, but I also think that it makes you wonder about taking every day. I mean, every day, to do as much in life now as you possibly can, I think. I think that's what's made me feel. That I want to do it.
Particularly with Andy being so young. He was the baby of the family.
Where do you go from here, though, career-wise?
Well, I certainly know what we're doing next
year. Well, we're looking at people who are our contemporaries when we first started off in England, who are out there now 10 years our senior touring, and they still love doing what they're doing, and we want to do the same thing.
We're having a wonderful time, and
we're going to keep making records, making a new album in January, February of 90.
And new world tour in 91.
We're going to be writing for films, and we're just going to go on and on.
Yeah,
and
the idea of being live is still with us. We're going to be touring again.
You're just going to go on and on.
Yep, I think so.
Yes. Barry, Morris, Robin, thanks for talking to Qantas Image.
Pleasure. Thank you.